ask your sister, the nervous system, and the lymphatic system. So, like I said in this video, there won't be any tapping. Imaginary planes. The sagittal plane divides the body into left and right halves. The descriptive terms medial and lateral correlate to the sagittal plane. The actions of flexion and extension occur along this plane. Center of the body, dividing the sagittal plane into two symmetrical sides. The frontal or coronal plane divides the body into front and back portions. The terms anterior and posterior relate to the frontal. Dividing the body into upper and lower parts is the transverse plane. This term's superior and inferior refer to the transverse plane. Rotation happens within this plane. So, let's see if you can go here. You have the different sides. Body is cut into a cross section. So next we have directions and positions. So specific terms are used to help communicate location, direction, and position of body structures. These terms replace more general references. Which are less precise and can be confusing. Each direction is paired up with its complementary direction. So, superior refers to a structure that is closer to the head. Inferior means closer to the feet. So, the shoulder superior to the knees, and the knees are inferior to the shoulders. So the terms cranium, which means closer to the head, and caudal, which means closer to the buttocks, are used when referring to structures on the trunk. For example, the umbilicus is caudal. Clavicles. The clavicles are cranial to the umbilicus. Posterior pertains to structures further towards the back of the body than another structure. Anterior refers to a structure further to the front. So the sternum is anterior to the spine. These directions ventral, which is anterior of the foot. So next we have medial, which pertains to a structure closer to the midline or center of the body. So lateral refers to a structure further away. Means a structure closer to the trunk. So these directions are used only when referring to arms and legs. So the elbow is proximal to the wrist, whereas the ankle is distal to the knee. So superficial describes a structure closer to the body's surface, whereas deep refers to a structure that is deeper in the body. So the pectoral major muscle, the pec muscles, are superficial to the ribs, whereas the ribs are deep to the pectoralis major. Next we have movements of the body. Movement of the body occurs at the joints, so where the bones articulate or connect. Although movement affects the placement of bones, the terminology of movements always refer to the joints, because if you move your bone, that means it's breaking down. So bending your knee is called flexion of the knee. So, flexion of the leg would require an ambulance. So, if you were to extend your fingers, flex your fingers, extend your fingers, flex your fingers. So, extension is the movement that straightens or opens a joint. In anatomical position, most joints are extended. So when you are standing up, most of our joints are extended. When a joint can extend beyond its normal range of motion, this is called hyperextension. So flexion is a movement that bends a joint or brings the bones closer together. In a fetal position, most joints are in a flexed position. So both flexion and extension take place along the sagittal plane. Adduction of a joint brings limbs medial towards the midline, which means adding to the body. Adduction, adding to the body. Abduction to move limbs laterally away from the midline. So abduct or carry away. These actions happen along the frontal plane and pertain only to the appendages, so your arms and legs. To abduct the fingers or toes is to bring them together. To abduct is to spread them. Next we have medial rotation and lateral rotation. So these are sometimes referred to as internal or external rotation. So these occur at the shoulder and hip joints. When the joint medially rotates the limb towards inward toward the midline, so rotation swings the arm away, or swings the limb away from the midline. So Then we have rotation, which returns only to the axial skeleton, so specifically the head. And then a table column, which would be your spine. So that's how we can rotate our bodies through rotation. So, rotation of the head and neck occurs as, say, a driver is turning to check behind them in a car. So, these movements happen along the transverse plane, so the plane that cuts the body in half. Next, we have circumduction. Circumduction is possible only at the shoulder and hip joints. It involves a combination of flexion, extension, adduction, and abduction. So together, these actions create a cone-shaped movement. So when we swing our arms around, that is what we're talking about as far as circumduction. Swimming the backstroke requires circumduction at the shoulder joint. So that's what you're doing while you're swimming. You're circumducting your shoulders. So then we have lateral flexion, which occurs only at the axial skeleton. So axial movement. For example, when the neck or the vertebral column bends laterally to the side. So that would be our lateral flexion. So elevation and depression refer to the movement of the scapula, which is the shoulder blade, and the jaw or our mandible. So elevation means movement superior. So when you elevate your scapula, you are raising your shoulders, elevating your shoulders. So depression is to move inferiorly. So when we are depressing our mandible, which is our jaw, we are opening our mouth. That would be depression. So supination. Pivoting action of the forearm. So our forearm. Supination, such as carrying a bowl of soup, occurs when the radius and ulna lie parallel to each other. So like this. So pronation, or prone to spill. When the radius crosses over the ulna, turning the palm downward. So, supination, pronation. So, like you're holding a bowl of soup. So, supination and pronation can also occur at the feet. Occur as a combination of movements of several joints of the feet. Inversion means to turn in, which elevates the foot on the medial side and brings the sole of the foot medially. Eversion means to turn out, elevates the foot's lateral side and moves the sole laterally. Which is where you're standing on the sides of your foot. And then eversion is where you're standing on the inside of your foot. Okay. So next we have plantar. plantar flexion and dorsiflexion. These only refer to movement at the ankle. So plantar flexion, which when you think of plantar, you can think of like the foot plantar fasciitis. That's how you can remember plantar flexion, dorsiflexion. By moving the ankle to a point on the foot with the earth or stepping on the pedal of your car. So if this was my foot, this would be a dorsiflexion because my foot is pressing down on the gas. Or excuse me, plantar flexion, not dorsi. Dorsi would be the back of the foot. So this would be plantar. Dorsiflexion is the opposite. So when you are tapping your foot, when you tap your foot, this would be the plantar flexion, dorsiflexion, plantar flexion, dorsiflexion. Next we have protraction and retraction, which pertain to the scapula, which is the shoulder blade. We have which is this bone right here, you can kind of see, clavicle, and then the head and jaw. So protraction means to protrude. So we look at our jaw, we are sticking out, that would be protraction. Retraction would be to bring it back to retreat. So protraction goes out, retraction comes in, which is pulling it back. So, deviation means to wander from the usual course. So, you probably know the word deviate if you are someone that tends to get off track. Someone may say, oh, you're deviating from the subject. So, the lateral deviation occurs at the mandible during talking and chewing. So that would be the deviation, just to move your jaw. So opposition is very interesting because this only happens on one part of the body. Only at the metacarpal joint of the thumb. So it occurs when the thumb pad crosses the palm toward your last finger. So again, this is the only place in the body that this occurs. So opposition is literally where you take your thumb, cross it to your pinky. So the thumb pad here, cross the palm like that. That's opposition. So you can take your thumb and it's a good trick question for your friends if you want to send me this. So from here we just have a little example where you can see the different flexion extension. So in the fingers and the mandible, which they all have very interesting names, but we'll talk about that in the next coming chapters. skeleton's center. So this red area would be the axle. So your skull, neck, is composed of arms and the legs, which includes the pectoral girdle, which is the pectoral girdle being here, where the scapula and the clavicle join into the ribs, and then also you have the pelvic girdle, which would be your pelvis here. So those are included in the appendicular skeleton. Next, also in the back of the body here, where we are highlighting the appendicular skeleton. So, interesting fact, the skeleton makes up 15% of our body weight. So, it's pretty good. I guess if you wanted to lose a few pounds, you could remove your lower floating ribs. Of half water and half solid material, and contain nearly 2 pounds of calcium and more than a pound of phosphorus. So that is enough phosphorus for 2,000 match heads. So essentially, you could grind up your bones and make 2,000 matches out of them. Another word for a joint would be articulation. So basically, a joint or articulation is the point of contact between bones. So a joint's structure determines its function. So this is pretty good information. All articulations have a fibrous cartilage synovial structure. So, because of their design, fibrous and cartilaginous joints have little or no movement capabilities. Synovial joints, however, contain a joint cavity, which is absent in fibrous and cartilaginous materials. This space allows movement. Basic structure components, they have different movement capabilities. So it's pretty interesting that even though they are basically structured similar, they have different movements. So there are 6 types of synovial joints. We have the ball and socket, ellipsoid, hinge, gliding, and pivot. So here, these are the examples of the different types of joints. So a ball and socket joint is a self-explanatory joint. You can pretty much use your imagination to figure out what that means. So a spherical surface of one bone fits into the disc-shaped depression of another bone. So, such a joint is capable of movement in every plane. So, the shoulder or the glenohumeral joint is an example of a joint that is capable of circumduction. So, here at the shoulder or the arm joint, into the shoulder here is called the glenohumeral joint, which choose an example because it can go in all directions. So next we have an ellipsoid joint. An ellipsoid joint looks a lot like this. So an ellipsoid joint consists of an oval shape and of one bone articulated with the elliptical basin of another bone. Extension and abduction and adduction as seen at the wrist or the radial carpal joint. So you would find the ellipsoid joint here in your wrist up here. So next we have a hinge joint, which allows only flexion and extension, similar to the movement of a door hinge. Hinge joint, door hinge. So an example of a hinge joint would be the elbow. So the elbow would be a good hinge joint, or the humeral ulnar joint. Humeral ulnar, because it has the humerus and ulnar bones. So next we have the saddle joint, which is a modified ellipsoid joint composed of convex and concave articulating surfaces. So basically like two saddles put together. The joint between the trapezium, which is one of the small carpal bones in the wrist, and the first metacarpal bones is an example of a saddle joint. So a saddle joint is one that you could find here. Next we have the gliding joint. So the gliding joint is usually between two flat surfaces and allows the least amount of movement of all the similar joints. So only small shifting movements are possible at these articulations, such as those between the carpal bones, the humerus, and the tarsal bones in the foot. So with the gliding joints, you would find those here in the carpal area, the carpal bones of the wrist, and in the foot around that same area, those would be the tarsal bones, and that's where you would find the gliding joint. So next, we have the pivot joint. So the pivot joint is designed to allow one bone to rotate around the surface of another bone, so like a pivot. For example, rotation of the head occurs because of a pivot joint between the first and second cervical vertebrae, the antelantoaxial joint. So basically, at the base of the skull would be your cervical spine, and that's what allows the head to move back and forth. So that would be where the pivot joint is. And I apologize, I don't know why the light is. So now that we have gone over the bones and joints, we will go ahead and move into the muscular system. We have a few pages left, maybe about 10 or so. I'm not going to name every single muscle that is listed in this picture, and that is simple because we will be going more in depth as we read through this book. So we're just going to kind of generally talk about what the muscles do, and then later on in later videos we will start going through the muscles section by section. So that'll be a lot of fun. So the muscular system, which is basically the system that allows our bones to move. Well, the muscle's name can give you clues to its specific features. If you ever want to know the name of a muscle, you can usually figure it out if you know where the muscle is attached. So, the name reflects either a muscle's shape, such as the rhomboids. Rhomboids are the muscles between the shoulder blades. Those are usually the muscles when you go to get a massage that feel really good when your massage therapist starts to move her thumbs or her elbows through. Or they can be named by their location, like the temporalis. So the temporalis is right here at the temples. Then we have its fiber direction, which would be the external obliques. And obliques, if you're someone that likes to work out, then you may know what the obliques are. They are the muscles at the sides of the abs. And next, we have their action, like the adductors. So the adductors are the muscles that help to bring them together. Then we also have their attachment sites, like the coracobrachialis. The coracobrachialis would be right here, not quite the biceps, but sort of in that area up there. Like I said, this is the baby back of the muscles. As you can see, right through here in the lumbar region, you have have muscles there, but there's not really a lot. It's actually a big shape of ligaments there. So the muscular system at either end of the muscle is a tendon, which attaches the muscles to the bones, which is what we talked about in the last video. So each muscle has an origin and an insertion. Origin is an attachment to the more stationary bone, while the insertion is the connection of the more mobile bone. So, basically, the bones that have less movement would be your insertion point. Origin, and then the bones that have movement would be the insertion point. So, as you can see, we have lots and lots of muscles. There are 639 named muscles in the human body. So, that is a lot of muscles to go through. So, that's why we're now going to end them all here in this posterior view, because as we go through the book, we are going to be learning about all 639. The lateral view, the side of the muscular system. So, next we have the fascial system. So, the fascia is interesting. That we were talking about the last video. So, the fascial system. So, basically, we just had some photos. So, this has the following illustrations showing aspects of the fascia from both a topographical and cross section viewpoints. I won't spend much time on the fascia only because I really quality is very poor, so it is hard to see, but this does sort of show a cross section here. But if you want, you can get Google and look up the rest of the fascia. This kind of just continues to talk about the fascial system here. So, we have the cardiovascular system. assemble a pretty complicated system here. So, cardiovascular system is the arteries and veins. They're the blood vessels of the cardiovascular system, so your arteries and veins. Remember, the arteries are the ones that you can feel the pulse. So, like the one in your neck here. They form an amazing network that transports blood from the heart and brings it to the body's tissues and then carries it back to the heart. So, arteries carry blood away from the heart. So, as an artery moves away from the heart, it divides into smaller branches. These smaller branches are arterioles, which are the smallest branches, which divide you've heard the word before, capillaries. The walls of the capillaries serve as drain and waste exchange sites between the body's tissues and the blood. So the capillaries then merge back together, creating small veins or venules, which then reunite to form the larger veins. The first one would be the arteries, and the arteries are the systems that take blood away from the heart. Then we have the veins, and the veins are these are the funnels that carry blood back to the heart to be recycled. So, it seems a little confusing that the names of arteries and veins change as they progress through the body. So, similar to the way the name of a road changes as it crosses a border into another country. So, for example, the subclavian artery, axillary artery, and brachial artery are all in the same vessel. Its name changes as it passes through different regions of the body. So, that's pretty interesting because the subclavian start here at the clavicle. As it travels down from the clavicle, the subclavian artery then becomes the axillary artery, and the axillary area is here in the armpits. So after, it then goes down to the brachial area, which would be right here. So the subclavian then it travels down and becomes the axillary. Many nerves branch off of your spinal cord and exit to the sides of your vertebrae. So, some of these nerves regroup to form a plexus. As we discussed, a plexus is like a bundle of nerves. So, the main plexus are the cervical, which is up here in the neck, lumbar and sacral. So we can kind of discuss that a little bit. So the cervical plexus would be up here in the neck. Next we have the brachial plexus, would be in this section here. So brachial would be up in this area. Then we have the lumbar plexus, which would be down here near the lumbar region of the back. And then last we have the sacral plexus, which is sacral is that flat bone at the very end of the back, on either side of the gluteal muscles. So the individual branches of a nerve plexus split off and have names that correspond with the region they innervate. So it's pretty cool too. Yeah. Alright, so the last section that we have is the lymphatic system. I really can't really see all that well, but we've got the lymphatic system. The lymphatic system is composed of several organs. Yellow fluid called lymph. So microscopic vessels called lymphatics and lymphatics. So these structures perform many functions throughout the body, such as draining the interstitial fluid, which is like some capillaries, and transporting it back to the heart. Lymphatic vessels carry fats from intestines to the body. Lymphatic tissue also helps the body's immune system defend against foreign cells, microbes, and cancer cells. So, that is it for this section of the body, where we talked about the different movements and the functions of the different structures of the body. So, in the next video, we will discuss the shoulder and arm muscles. So, again, if you have any suggestions or requests that you would like to make, feel free to leave me a comment. Also, don't forget to subscribe.